Hey everybody, it's Alex with Engineering Applied. In this video, I'll be showing you how to create and animate adaptive springs within an Autodesk Inventor assembly file. If you want more easy to understand and practical content like this, made by an experienced engineer like myself, make sure you like this video, subscribe to the channel, and turn on notifications so you don't miss out on any helpful content like this in the future. If you're looking for a specific function, check the description for timestamps, and if you don't find what you're looking for in this video, make sure you check out the other videos in my Autodesk Inventor series playlist because I know you'll find exactly what you need there. Let's get started. Okay, everybody, so here we are in our blank assembly file. And for this particular lesson, I'll be breaking this up into two main examples. Our first example consists of a simple application for this adaptive spring, and that is a bottom plate that's stationary. We have a top plate that moves down, and as it moves down, it compresses the spring. Now, for the second example, we'll be taking a look at a valve train assembly, which consists of a rotating camshaft that pushes up on a follower, which causes a rocker arm to pivot and push down on a valve. Now, attached to this valve, there's a valve spring retainer that compresses the spring. So this should make for a very cool visual, and it'll allow you to see a more advanced use case for this particular function. Now let's go ahead and get started with our first example. So what we need to do here is we need to go ahead and place a couple of these base plates that allow for the compression of the spring. So we'll go to base plate. Okay. And I'm going to right click to go into my marking menu, and I'm going to click on place grounded at origin because I want this bottom plate to remain stationary. So I'll just click on that and it'll drop that first one down. Now let's go ahead and drop another one, but let's first rotate this so that the pocket faces downward. So this little opening on the top, we need that to face downward. So we'll right click, rotate about Z. We'll do that twice. And then let's left click to drop it anywhere. Okay, and once we do that, we'll right click to go into our marking menu and click OK. And there we go. Now we need to create a mate between these two components to get them aligned vertically. To do that, I'm going to go up to constrain, and I'm going to use the mate variant up here in the assembly tab. And I'm just gonna select the cylindrical face of both parts, and that aligns both their central axis elements to one another. So then we'll go ahead and click OK. And then now I can just sort of click and drag this top one up and down, but it remains vertical with respect to the central axis of these two components. So once we have that set up, we need to set up a mate constraint between this face here and this pocket and this face down here. And the reason why we're doing that is this will allow us to drive that constraint or the distance between these two components so that we can see the compression of the spring. Now, if you're unfamiliar with how to create assembly constraints, I encourage you to pause this video and then go watch my assembly constraints tutorial video so that you can resume this one with as much information as possible, because it's important that you are aware of all of the tools that are available and how to use these constraints to get this adaptive spring to move in the way that you want it to. Moving on, let's go ahead and create our secondary mate constraint. So we'll leave the type set to mate, and we're going to set an offset between this face and this top pocket and this face and the bottom pocket. Okay, so I'm going to select those two faces and I'm going to set this offset to 1.5 inches. Okay, so this is the uncompressed resting position of the spring. And I'm going to give this a custom name so that I know which mate to drive when we go to actually drive the spring movement. So I'm going to just type mate drives spring, okay? And as your assemblies get larger, it's always a good idea to apply custom names to your constraint so that you know exactly what you're looking at. So we'll go ahead and click OK. Now, let me go ahead and give you a quick preview of how this top plate moves. So going under the relationships folder here in the model browser, we're going to go to that second mate constraint that we created. So this is the offset between this face here and this face here. And we're going to right click and go to drive. Now that we're in our drive menu, let's go ahead and take a look at a couple key parameters. So this first box houses our start parameter. So this is our starting offset between these two faces that I designated. Okay, this is our end parameter. So this is where the top plate will end up in relation to this bottom plate with regards to that offset. So between this face down here and this face up here, it will have an offset of 1.25 inches. Okay, let's open up our extended menu by clicking these double arrows. And then I wanna just mention here, I have the drive adaptivity option checked. So when you have adaptive entities in your assembly, you want to make sure this is checked when you're driving those parts, or else it'll break your simulation. So we want to leave that checked. And then let's go down to the increment section. So I set it as a function of total number of steps. Okay. And I have 50 steps. So when we have the spring here, it's essentially going to redraw that spring 50 times as it compresses. So that's what's actually displaying that compression of the spring. So now let's go ahead and just hit this reverse button, and you'll see the top plate moves down by a quarter of an inch, and then we can go forward and it'll move back up again. Now let's go ahead and draw up our spring. So we're going to go to the create command under the component section, and I'm going to rename this component. I'm going to call this spring example one. And we're saving it as a standard part file, and it's saved in the correct location. We'll click OK. And we'll select this face here as our starting reference plane. And when we do that, it automatically opens up the editing menu for this particular spring. So I'm technically still in the assembly file, but I'm actually editing that spring part that I just created. Let's go ahead and start our first sketch. So we'll open up this origin folder under the spring part. Okay, and let's look at a plane that we want to sketch on. So let's actually sketch on the XZ plane. So I will right click on that and go to new sketch. And here we're going to sketch the cross section profile of the spring itself. So this is where I start referencing and projecting the geometry of these other two plates in my assembly. Let's go ahead and start projecting our geometry. So I'm going to click on project geometry, and I'm going to project this edge on the bottom of this pocket here, and then this edge on top. Remember, since we're on a two-dimensional plane, when we project these circular elements, it'll just show up as a line, okay? And what we're going to do is we're going to put a driven dimension between these two lines, okay? So we're gonna put a distance dimension between these two lines, and it's going to give me an error. And it basically says that this dimension will overconstrain the sketch, and it's asking me whether or not I want to leave it as a driven dimension. So I want to go ahead and accept that. And you'll notice around the dimension value, it puts parentheses. That means that this is a driven dimension, meaning that this actually isn't driving the offset. It's the offset that's driving the number inside of this field, okay? But that's really important because we can reference this particular driven dimension, which will then drive the height of the spring. So as this top plate moves down, it changes the overall height of the spring. And that's what gives you the appearance of compression in your spring. So now that we have that, we need to create a couple other elements here. So we need to go ahead and create a vertical axis. So we'll just pick up the center point here and just bring up a line. And we'll go ahead and just right click and go to OK. And then we're going to change these three entities to reference geometry. So I'm just going to highlight all of those, right click and go to construction, because this is all just for reference. And the last thing we need in this particular sketch is we need the cross section shape of our spring. So I'm going to drop a circle here. Okay, let's go ahead and dimension that. So this is, I want it to be 0.135 inches. Okay, and I want this to be tangent to this bottom line because I want the spring to set flush on this bottom surface here. But I want to go ahead and set the radius of the spring, or, you know, of course, you double the radius, you get the diameter of the spring. So we'll go to OK, and we'll set a distance parameter between the center of this circle and this center axis here. And I want that to be 0.450. Okay. And you'll see we have a little extra gap on the side there just to account for tolerances. And that looks good to me. So what I'll do is I'll finish this sketch. And now let's take a look at creating the actual coil or the spring itself. To do that, we're going to use the coil command up here at the top. Now, if you're unfamiliar with how to use the coil command, I encourage you to go watch the video I made on that because it goes through all of the specific details that are associated with using this particular tool. Okay, so you'll see that my profile is pre-selected. That's this circular cross-section shape. If it's not pre-selected, you just want to click inside of this box and you'll get this little blue line that pops up, okay? That says that this profile selection filter is active, so we can just hover over our profile and left click. And then we want to click in our axis selection filter box and you'll see we got our blue line. So let's go ahead and select this axis that I put into the sketch, okay? And you'll see it gives me a preview of the coil. Now, we want to make sure our method is set properly for this particular use case, which revolution and height is what I want to use. So it's going to count how many turns are in this coil and then its overall height. So this looks good to me. Now we're going to clear the height box. And so to have the proper adaptive characteristics of this spring, you want to go over to the right and click on this little arrow. Okay. And we're actually going to use this driven dimension that we created earlier as this height. Okay, so as this plate changes its position in relation to the bottom one, this number will change and it will set the height value, which will effectively redraw the spring every time this plate moves. So that's going to give us the appearance of a compressing and decompressing spring. Let's go ahead and click on select feature dimension, and let's hover over our driven dimension that we want to pick up. But notice it doesn't allow us to click on that. So all we have to do is go back to this height field, click on that arrow, and then click on select feature dimension again. And now we can click on this dimension. You'll see we get our little function symbol that pops up to the right of the mouse cursor. When we click on that, it populates the height field with a tag designated as D0. So this tag is essentially just a name that's associated with this particular dimension here. Okay, so depending on how many dimensions you have before this particular one in your assembly, this could be called D5, D10, so on and so forth. But again, since I didn't know what this particular dimension was called, that's why I used that select feature dimension option. Now, before we move on, I need to add another element to this height setting, because if I were to just click OK, some of the spring would be cut off at the top here. So we need to take away the diameter of the cross section to account for that. So we'll just add this here that says minus 0.135, which is the diameter of the cross section for the spring. And now when it draws the spring, it'll set flush against this top face. And again, I have my close start and close end settings set appropriately such that I get a little bit more of the spring setting flush to either one of these surfaces. So I'll click OK. And it draws up the spring. So let's go ahead and take a section view of that. Go to view, half section view, and then we'll select the end of the spring. So let's find that there. Okay. And you'll see, so the top of the spring is setting flush on this face, and then the bottom portion of the spring is setting flush on this face. So that's exactly what we want. Okay. So we'll just go ahead and exit out of that. And let's go ahead and drive this assembly. So what we want to do first is we want to click this return button to actually get out of the editor for this part here. So we can hit return. And now we're actually back in our assembly file. So we're at the assembly level again. And I want you to go ahead and take note of this little symbol here. So this blue and red arrow. Okay, so that's essentially just designating this particular part as an adaptive part, meaning that it's referencing geometry in the assembly and it's subject to change based on the position of the geometry in the assembly itself. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to right click on this mate that actually drives the location of this top plate. We're going to right click on that and go to drive. And let's just verify that all of our settings are properly set. So our start looks good. Our end setting looks good. Okay, so we're getting a quarter of an inch of compression. And we have this drive adaptivity box checked. So again, that will allow these adaptive parts to change as the location of the parts that they're referencing are moving. Okay, and then our increment looks good. So we're taking 50 steps here. So we'll go ahead and hit this reverse arrow and see what happens. So as we hit reverse, you'll see the spring is beginning to compress. And again, so every step or every increment, the spring is essentially being redrawn. So let's go back forward again to the decompression. Okay, we'll let it extend all the way. Now let's set the endpoint to something larger. So let's set it to 1.75. So it's actually going to extend beyond its resting position. So you can actually make springs that also extend. Okay, so you see the spring is being stretched out. So this works in both directions. So we'll go ahead and hit cancel there. And now let's jump to our more complicated second example where we take a look at a valve train assembly. Okay, here is our sample valve train assembly. And before we go ahead and draw up the spring here, I want to go ahead and simulate the motion of this assembly so we can see what's going on. So I'll go ahead and drive this camshaft drive angle constraint. We'll hit play. You'll see the camshaft rotates and pushes up on that follower and it pushes down on the valve. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to put a spring setting on this surface here and pushing up against this valve spring retainer. Okay, and that's what keeps this follower pressed firmly against the cam surface. Okay, so let's go ahead and create our valve spring. So we'll go to create. I'm going to rename this to example 2 valve spring. All right, we'll click okay. And I'll select this face here as our starting plane. Now we're currently editing the valve spring part file. And so For this particular example, I want to create some reference geometry. In this case, that'll be some reference planes, and we'll use that to set the spring gap and compression. We'll come over here and select the offset from plane option, and we'll go ahead and select this surface here and set it to a zero offset. Okay, we'll do the same thing up top. Set that to 0 inches and hit okay. Okay, so now let's go ahead and start creating our 2D sketch on the XZ plane. So we'll right click on that, go to new sketch. Okay, so let's go ahead and start projecting some geometry. So the first bit of geometry that we'll be selecting here is this surface or this edge. Okay, so once we have that edge, we'll go ahead and pick up these two edges down here. All right, let's go ahead and create a line across those two. And the reason we're doing this is so we can use the center point here for our axis. All right, let's go ahead and set our general dimension between these two planes. And this will allow us to get our driven dimension. Okay, and now we want to go ahead and drop our circular profile. Set it tangent to this line down here. Let's actually set it tangent to the line that's associated with this plane. Okay, we'll set our gap. All right, so this all looks good. So we'll go to okay and finish 2D sketch. And now let's go ahead and create this coil. Pick up our axis, clear our height field. Remember, if you can't pick up this dimension after selecting select feature dimension, what you can do is go back to this arrow and then hit select feature dimension an additional time. And then now we can pick that up. We'll go ahead and take away the diameter of the coil from that. And everything else looks good. So we'll hit OK. And now let's take a look at what the driving angle does to this assembly. I'm now back at the assembly level. So let's go ahead and drive this camshaft drive angle constraint and see what happens with the spring. So let me zoom in just a little bit here and we'll right click on this, go to drive and let's hit play. And you can see the follower moves up, the rocker arm goes down, pushes the valve down, which compresses that spring. Okay, so it's gonna go around one more time. Now you notice the reference plane on top is moving down. And you know, in example one, you saw that we referenced the surfaces directly on our actual plates. This time around, we're just referencing the work planes that are in turn referencing the solid surfaces themselves. So you have plenty of flexibility available to you here. And I think this will add a nice amount of detail to your models. That's all for this segment of the Autodesk Inventor Assembly Creation Module, where I showed you how to create and animate adaptive springs. I really hope that you found this tutorial to be helpful and that you put what you've learned into practice so you can continue developing your skills as you work your way through these lessons. Also, before you watch the next video in the series, make sure you subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications to stay up to date on future content that's going to help you create the future you want for yourself. And of course, don't hesitate to leave a comment or reach out via my website contact page and let me know if there's anything else you'd like to learn about or see on this channel. I really appreciate you choosing to stop by and learn with me, and I'll see you again soon.